Continuing with the juvenile with rheumatological conditions, we have juvenile dermatomyositis. It is rare, okay. Also, it is inflammatory disease combining skin and muscle manifestations, associated also with vasculitis, okay. So that would present with systemic manifestations as a condition of all rheumatological diseases. This is a disease of girls, usually between 5 and 10 years age. Autoimmune conditions that attack muscles and blood vessels. Characteristics, we have a positive ANA, one of differential diagnosis of positive ANA, and some myositis specific antibodies. The diagnosis in the past was based on muscle biopsy to show the inflammatory infiltrates of and the muscle fiber degeneration and regeneration. Calcinosis is a common feature of dermatomyositis in children with deposition of calcium salts in skin or muscles. Okay, about 40% of cases complicated by calcinosis. So we have insidious onset of a prodrome of systemic manifestations, lethargy, irritability, fatigue, and so on. And then about several months later, the characteristic features of dermatomyositis appear. This includes the rash of dermatomyositis. It's called the heliotrope rash, having a violaceous or purplish color in the periorbital area, maybe associated with periorbital edema. This is very characteristic. Okay. Plus, the muscle manifestation in the form of muscle weakness, mostly proximal muscle weakness. Okay, so we have fever, we have skin manifestations in the form of periorbital heliotrope eruption and the Gottron papules. These are the Gottron papules, which is a sort of a skin vasculitis presenting on extensor surfaces of joints, especially here in the metacarbopharyngeal joints and here maybe in the elbow joints. These are maybe in the knee and so on, ankles. So these are Gottron papules. Okay, one of the skin manifestations of dermatomyositis. Muscle disease in the form of proximal weakness and muscle pain and tenderness on palpation, beside limbing, okay, palate dysfunction, swallowing dysfunction, one of early manifestations of the disease. Other systemic involvement as a sort of vasculitis include connective tissue disease, so include arthralgia and joint swelling may occur, pulmonary pneumonitis by inflammatory infiltrates, myocarditis presenting with arrhythmias, and GIT dysfunction, all these as a matter of vasculitis. The workup usually it is a clinical diagnosis having the characteristic rash and the Gottron papules plus the proximal muscle weakness, may starting in the palate and swallowing dysfunction associated with the systemic manifestations of fever, fatigue, irritability, and so on. In a girl less than 10 years, usually should be sufficient for diagnosis. Muscle enzymes in the form of creatine kinase and lactate dehydrogenase are high. MRI is a diagnostic modality of choice, showing the inflammatory myopathy and they can guide the site of biopsy. Biopsy to show the degeneration and regeneration of muscles and inflammatory infiltrates. EMG would be used to show the myopathic changes. These are MRI showing the calcinosis of skin and muscles associated with the dermatomyositis. The treatment, as any rheumatological condition, have the basis of use of corticosteroids and immune suppressive drugs. Okay, but as general measures, physiotherapy to preserve muscle power and to avoid development of contractures, very, very important. Support in the form of nasogastric tube feeding for the palatal dysfunction and respiratory support for the respiratory dysfunction. Corticosteroids, sometimes in severe disease, severe presentation, IV course of methylprednisolone for about 3 days, followed by the oral prednisolone, 1 to 2 milligrams per kg per day, guided by the clinical resolution and improvement, then gradual tapering. Cytotoxic agents in the form of mesotrexate, cyclosporin, azacitidine may be added, hydroxychloroquine for skin disease, sometimes IVIG would be required. Also one of rheumatological condition, BEHCET, small idea about it. It's a clinical triad of recurrent, oral, ulcers, genital ulcers plus uveitis. Okay, oral and genital ulcers on recurrent basis plus uveitis. It is Behcet syndrome, one of rheumatological conditions more common in males. Wow. Also can have joint disease. Sjögren's syndrome, also it is a triad, having the dry eye, dry mouth, plus salivary gland affection or parotitis. Okay, so keratoconjunctivitis or dry eyes, maybe ulceration can occur, dry mouth, and parotitis that can occur as alone, single entity, or can be associated with lupus, for example, or other rheumatological disease. Scleroderma, okay, but also a small idea about scleroderma, one of the rheumatological conditions. From its name, it affects mainly the skin associated with sclerosis or fibrosis and stiffening. Okay, this can be localized, which is the main presentation in children, or can be systemic, that's called the systemic sclerosis, being less common in children. Localized scleroderma having forms like morphea, for example, when it is localized area of stiffened second skin with loss of subcutaneous tissue, being glistening in the start and then losing luster and so on. This is morphea, localized area, or can be linear second oblique like that. If it this linear lesion across a joint, it would result in contractures and impairment of bone growth and even up to limb length discrepancy. If occurring in the face, forehead, and the scalp, it is called onchodysplasia. Okay, systemic sclerosis having skin, one of its manifestations presenting with calcinosis cutis, other features in the form of Raynaud phenomena, even esophageal hypomotility, sclerodactyly, respiratory GIT or renal disease, all these can accompany. It has its specific antibodies in workup and associated with systemic manifestations, and also if treatment if required will be in the form of corticosteroid and immune suppressant. Childhood vasculitis is an important category of medicine. We have given idea about it in the chapter of nephrology. It is one of the rheumatological conditions that associated with systemic features of chronic inflammation, plus being chronic, okay, plus having common features of skin and joint diseases, predilection to renal disease, and then other systemic manifestations may occur. Starting with the aorta and its main branches, so vasculitis, we have example of Takayasu arthritis. Then medium-sized vessels, when have vasculitis, we have the polyarthritis nodosa and the Kawasaki disease mentioned in the chapter of cardiology. Then going to smaller blood vessels, we have the ANCA-associated vasculitis. This is a specific antibody called the anti-neutrophil cytoplasmic antibody affecting medium and small-sized vessels. We have the famous example of Wegener granulomatosis. When small vessels which are affected, okay, small vessel vasculitis includes the Henoch-Schönlein purpura as an example. So starting with polyarthritis nodosa, it is a small to medium-sized vasculitis that can be generalized or can be cutaneous form only, presenting with the skin manifestations and nodules. 3 to 60 year age period has predilection for polyarthritis nodosa as a rheumatological disease, so present with fever, abdominal pain, myalgia, arthralgia, and so on. Skin disease, okay, that can be sticky or can be purple. So we have rashes and the tender subcutaneous nodules, okay, and livid reticularis and the cutaneous form. We have cutaneous form of polyarthritis nodosa having the tender nodules along the pathway of blood vessels. Okay, you should be aware of this condition as it can be can have disastrous course ending by thrombosis in the periphery and even gangrene like in this picture. So from its name we have tender subcutaneous nodule along the pathway of blood vessels. In the generalized form we have hypertension, it is a form of vasculitis, and we have renal disease, neurological disease, so any combination would occur plus the chronic systemic manifestations and acute high acute phase reactant, high ESR, high CRP, high ferritin, and so on. Normocytic normochromic anemia as a chronic inflammatory condition. Leukocytosis, thrombocytosis may occur. Urinary screening may show the hematuria, proteinuria, and the casts if renal disease is present. Usually, the diagnosis will be based on biopsy and histological findings of focal necrosis in small and medium-sized arteries. So this is a histological finding of biopsy specimen showing affection of medium-sized vessel with inflammation and inflammatory infiltrate and the thickening of the wall. This is showing the periphery affected by the vasculitis that may end if not diagnosed and treated by the gangrene. This is the angiography showing the pathology in the arteries with the characteristic nodules of polyarthritis nodosa. Prognosis depend on systemic manifestations. Treatment will be in the form of steroid and immune suppressant. About Takayasu or joint cell arthritis, it is pain arthritis of aorta and its large branches, where the whole length of aorta and its large branches are affected by the condition, which can result in thrombosis, stenosis, or occlusion of these vessels, presenting with claudication, okay, in arms or legs. And the very characteristic sign of absent pulses. If any time mentioned you absent pulses plus systemic manifestations and maybe claudication or any thrombotic manifestations, you would consider Takayasu disease. Okay, associated logically with hypertension, systemic manifestations, and high acute phase reactant, the normocytic normochromic anemia, leukocytosis, and the thrombocytosis, with a diagnostic imaging modality of Doppler ultrasound, showy, and angiography combination. Okay, to visualize the pathology and the aorta and the large branches and the associated stenosis or aneurysm formation. Steroid and immune suppressive therapy and reconstructive surgery would be required. Another form of vasculitis is vasculitis with granuloma or granuloma formation. It is a small to medium-sized vasculitis. We have two main syndromes, the Wegener granulomatosis and the Short Stress syndrome. Wegener has a newer name. It's called polyangiitis with granulomatosis, I think. Or granulomatosis with polyangiitis. It is a small vessel vasculitis. In Wegener, there is affection of the upper and the lower respiratory tract, very, very common. Okay. Vasculitis in these areas associated with granuloma formation that can appear here in an endoscopy of the nasal cavities, showing the these nodules in the nasal cavity. Accompanying the granuloma formation associated with the systemic manifestations of here nasal affection presenting with the stuffiness, stuffed nose or nosebleeds, and finally destruction by the granuloma and the infarction and the destruction of the this nasal cavity will end by saddle nose. A systemic manifestation, pericarditis can be present, skin nodules or purpura, glomerulonephritis can be present with normal complement level. Wegener is one of the differential diagnoses of glomerulonephritis with normal complement levels. Please refer to the chapter of nephrology. Also, lungs can be affected by pneumonitis or bilharzia, and eyes also can be affected. So, again, having systemic manifestations associated with granuloma formation that usually seen in biopsy specimen, and you have differential diagnosis of granulomatous diseases, includes the TB, for example, having caseating granuloma. And the Wegener also is one of the differential diagnosis of granuloma formation. So when this present in upper and lower respiratory, presenting with pneumonitis manifestations and upper airway obstruction, ending by saddle nose, glomerulonephritis as vasculitis, pulmonary granulomas, a destructive granuloma of ear, nose, and the sinuses, rashes, as skin disease, as any rheumatological condition, positive ANCA antibodies or antineutrophil cytoplasmic antibodies. This is Wegener, and steroid immune suppressive again all the treatment lines. What's called short stress is a variant of Wegener. Also, it is a small vessel vasculitis, but usually associated with eosinophilic condition like asthma and eosinophilia in the full blood count. pulmonary infiltrates plus rashes plus renal disease. Okay, all these can manifestations, the diagnosis will be based on association with asthma and eosinophilia and the characteristic histological finding of agranuloma with eosinophilic infiltration. Now, going to some miscellaneous disorders, including the hemihypertrophy, when one side is larger than the other side, can be limited. Maybe one part of the face, one side of the face is larger than the other side. Maybe one arm is larger than the other arm. One leg is more than, larger. Or it can be taking the whole one side of the body is larger than the other body. So this is hemihypertrophy, and this can be congenital, with tissues are normal, functioning tissues, okay, or can be secondary to other more serious condition like neurofibromatosis, for example, like hemangiomas, like lymphangiomas, that cause elongation of one limb being more hypertrophied than the other. This is differential diagnosis. One famous syndrome associated with hemihypertrophy is the Pickles-Wiedemann syndrome, previously discussed. It is a fetal overgrowth syndrome presenting with pre or postnatal overgrowth. The neonate is macrosomic, having his length and weight above the 97th percentile, with associated with macroglossia, associated with abdominal wall defect like exomphalos. So these three major criteria defining the Pickles-Wiedemann syndrome. Some other minor criteria may or may not be present, like the characteristic ear signs having creases or beds in the ear, okay, or the ear lobule, having facial nevus flammus, having hypoglycemia, usually in the neonatal period and usually mild and transient, having organomegaly, okay, hemihypertrophy in quarter of cases, and as natural history of the condition, usually this overgrowth will slow down in late childhood, with the adults with Pickles-Wiedemann syndrome usually less than 97th centile. There is what is important here, we have predilection for neoplasia, about 5% of them have predilection for Wilms tumor, especially this can be scenario in the exam, very important. So they have predilection for Wilms, for adrenocortical carcinoma, for hepatoblastoma and neuroblastoma. And for this, many centers advocate long-term follow-up with regular abdominal palpation, radiographs, and regular ultrasound examination as a screening for these risks. Okay, by adolescence, majority of those children lead a normal life. Back pain is a quite common presentation in childhood that can be related only to hypermobility, that is a common entity in a childhood period, presenting with back pain. Okay, trauma may be the cause, spondylitis, inflammation of spinal discs, TB of vertebral column, maybe leukemia with 60% presenting with MSK manifestations, maybe ankylosing spondylitis, a form of GIA, or it may be tumor like Ewing tumor and osteoma. As workup, okay, we do a plain radiograph for the back, bone scan, MRI, and full blood count with ESR, trying to find the diagnosis. Torticollis, okay, this is an infant with torticollis with the cause here is the sternomastoid tumor. Sternomastoid tumor also is a quite common presentation during the neonatal and early months of life period, having some mass here in the sternomastoid muscle, okay, causing shifting of the head to one side like this. This is limitation of movement of the neck, okay, that can be diagnosed on the basis of ultrasound examination, and usually it is a benign condition requiring physiotherapy and maybe fomentation. Okay, so sternomastoid is also a common question in the exam. Sometimes the cause is vertebral or due to muscular spasm or maybe pharyngitis with lymphadenopathy causing the torticollis. There is possibility of retropharyngeal abscess if you're having a scenario of child with toxemia, high grade fever, and history of tonsillitis, after subsidence, three coming of the manifestations with maybe dysphagia and or refusal of feeling, and the plain X-ray cervical spine showing the wide retropharyngeal space. So think of this possibility. Sandifier syndrome associated with the gastroesophageal reflux may cause torticollis or the arched back, and spinal tumor. Juvenile idiopathic arthritis also can be the cause for torticollis. Finally, hypermobility. Hypermobility is the most common cause of MSK complaints in the childhood age period, where children are hypermobile or have hypermobile joints more commonly than adults, with prevalence of about 5 to 30% of children have hypermobility. The usual presentation of hypermobility is in the form of joint pain, especially after exercise or nighttime pain and so on. These symptoms include growing pain, especially at night, and back pain. This is related to hypermobility, commonly in pediatric age group. Up to 10% of school-aged children have loose joints, and occasional pain after exercise or at night. This is very important and very common presentation in the pediatric clinics. Natural history, it improves with age, okay, but has differential diagnosis of some syndromes that has autosomal dominant pattern of inheritance. These include the Marfan syndrome and Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. The usual treatment for this benign hypermobility, commonly presenting in childhood, is exercise to build up strength of the muscles and reassurance of the parents. Okay, so what about the differential diagnosis of this benign hypermobility? We have Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. It is an inherited group of disorders of connective tissue characterized by having joint hypermobility like that, okay, and skin hyperextensibility like this, okay, and easy bruising, okay, with rupture of the blood vessels, and even up to rupture of organs may occur. So in less common, more severe conditions. So the most consistent features are having joint hypermobility, and this have testing, we will mention it now, and skin hyperextensibility, producing this test to find the skin hyperextensibility. Sometimes may or may not be present, having the easy bruising, having the scars in the skin that are called cigarette paper scars. They have predilection to having mitral valve prolapse, and even having aneurysms and rupture of arteries may occur. You have Marfan has a serious complication of aortic aneurysm or dissection, if you remember. So overall incidence of Ehlers-Danlos is about 1 in 5,000 cases. It is a clinical diagnosis, usually have family history. It is autosomal dominant condition, and there is no specific treatment for this. Just muscle strengthening exercises and supplying orthoses, okay, maybe to aid relieving pains and providing more much easier movements and support for the joints and so on. Another entity, isolated entity called the benign joint hypermobility syndrome. So it is a syndrome of joint hypermobility with musculoskeletal pain. Again, hypermobility result in musculoskeletal pains. Look at this elbow joint that is hypermobile, hyperextensible like this, or hyperextended. So symptoms of hypermobility syndrome, again, we have joint pains, usually the presenting features. Typically, this pain affect multiple joints, especially weight-bearing joints like knee and ankle, especially after physical activity. Back pain is common in adolescents, hip pain also, especially in dancers and active children. History of flat feet can be present as accompanying features, and abnormal gait also like knock knees may be present. We have two major signs for diagnosis of this syndrome. Byton score of more of 5 or more, score of 5 or more of Byton score is diagnostic. Okay, and arthralgia, having arthralgia for more than 3 months and 4 or more joints. Okay, what is Byton score? It is clinical testing for having hypermobility in children, including these that include having hyperextended knee joints like this, and having hyperextended elbow joints, having hyperextensible little and some fingers, okay, hypermobile, hypermobile thumb, hypermobile little finger, plus the ability of the child to touch the ground with his both hands while extending the knees like this. So this score, having the getting 4 points or more, it's called, so it is positive for having hypermobility. Plus other minor features that may or may not be present, like skin stria due to skin fragility, skin hyperextensibility as present in Ehlers-Danlos, having the marfanoid habitus of being very tall and having the arachnodactyly and other marfanoid features, hernia, mitral valve prolapse. Combination of these all can give the diagnosis of benign joint hypermobility syndrome as the cause for joint pains following exercises. So it is a diagnosis of exclusion. Especially, you need to exclude inflammatory and rheumatological conditions we have mentioned, and the infectious causes also for the joint disease should be excluded.